morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. Welcome in. If you made it in just before the rain, yeah. If you made it in through the rain, yeah. If you're still coming in through the rain, yeah. You're here. Praise God. Thank you for being here. Real quick announcement. This coming Saturday, so following the work week or the weekdays, on Saturday we'll be, yeah, could you turn this down in the monitor to Desi, obviously we'll get some feedback. I don't know if you can get that or not. So that's number two. Yep. So this coming Saturday is work day. Oh, there was a slide. Look right there. Saturday, September 17th at 9 a.m. Church work day. And come on out. And lots of things that can be done that day to help prepare us for. Yes?
We'll also need someone with a chainsaw because part of that work day is the wood up at the parsonage.
Wood at the parsonage is part of that day. So, oh, yep, we'd see another hand.
We could use people that have pickup trucks. They wouldn't mind making a couple of trucks over directly to get wood for our parsonage. We have a bunch donated, and it needs to be worked and brought back to the parsonage. It's a huge savings for our church that when people donate this wood, so we try to get it as quickly as possible. So if you have a pickup or a trailer you want to haul some wood with, we'd be glad to have you.
Awesome. So, yeah, it's a church work day, so people, trucks, chainsaws, you name it. There's plenty to do and lots to accomplish as we head into, look at that date, September 17th. By then we'll be over halfway through September. Yeah, I see the blank stares at me. You know what's coming. You know what's headed here. That four-letter word, snow. Yeah, I can't wait. It's awesome. I love playing in the snow. But until then, let's enjoy what we have. Let's stand and we worship together. Oh, we do have our fellowship luncheon following the service as well today. Thank you for being here. Blessed be your name, Lord. We praise you today. Blessed be your name. Every blessing.
Thank you. about the lots and the maintenance company. Passport, several generations, we see it evolve, and then Ferris uses or something like that, have that music play for 2 seconds. If you can get it, that'd be cool. If not, it's fine.
Your grace.
our lungs. It is you who gives life. Lord, it is you that sustains us. And Lord, I thank you that by knowing your Son, Jesus Christ, that we eternally get to sing your praises. That we eternally get to shout your name. That we eternally get to enjoy your presence, Lord. I say thank you, thank you, thank you again and again. Even as we come to give the tithe and offering, Lord, help us to recognize how great you are. How you restore us. How you renew us. How you strengthen us. How you provide for us, yes. How you equip us. Even as I think about that strength that you provide, Lord, you give strength to us to endure that which we wonder how will we? And you provide strength. You provide hope. And Lord, in times that we don't understand, we struggle to comprehend, it is you who provides meaning as well and understanding. And yet we still have those moments where we don't comprehend. And as hard as it is even for me to contemplate that, Lord, I say thank you. That you would give us the ability, Father, to quiet our hearts and minds and thoughts long enough and be patient enough to wait on you and gain our strength from you, Lord. The God of all small g gods, the one true God, you alone. Thank you for the healing that you provide. I thank you did so through the words of Jesus Christ. It is by his wounds that we were healed, Lord, that we are healed. And for that, we say thank you. We give you all praise, all honor, and all glory in Jesus' precious name.
He was crushed for our sins, and the punishment. everybody.
Thank you.
I'm glad you're here to worship today. And part of our worship today gets to be communion. We get to break bread together and we get to worship in this way. This is for all believers and everybody who's here. It's a reminder to stay in right relationship with God when we take communion as well. Just that reminder that to examine ourselves before we take communion. But everybody who's here who knows Christ, I welcome you to join us in taking communion this morning. Here in 1 Corinthians, we're reminded of why we do it. In verse 23 here, he says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" We do this regularly here in our church family. We do this every month as a reminder, and every time we do it, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes. So that's why we celebrate together. That's why we share every month in this. It's not about rituals or traditions or anything like that. It's celebrating what God did for us through salvation. So now we're going to take together. Lon, would you like to pray for the first element?
Our Father God in heaven, we do thank you and praise you for this another day that you've given to us to meet here in this place to worship you, our Savior and King and Lord. We thank you for the sacrifice that you made on Calvary's cross for us. It's exemplified in the elements that we're about to partake. We ask your blessing upon them and upon each one who knows you and who partakes, Lord. We thank you for this time of fellowship together, and we ask your blessing in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Christ, for being obedient to the cross, going, sacrificing yourself, spilling out your blood for us, so that we can be right with Father, perfect Father in heaven. Jesus, we have forever to thank you, but hear us as we praise you now and thank you for loving us so much. Amen.
Thank you. made out of St. Louis. Thank you for bringing us to this place where we can worship you and where we can learn about you and more about the church, especially these young people and children's church. And learn how much you love them. Amen. Especially for us older children up here, too. Yeah. You know, I don't think I could have picked worse weather for today's message. It's warm, and it's raining, and it's dark, and we're talking about the law today. Not all Leviticus, though, so it's okay. We'll stay awake. We'll have to, or else we'll miss lunch later. Now, today's message is one that comes from Philippians chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. That's where we've been going as I get to speak here. We've been going through the book of Philippians. And this one's a little bit different. So this one has to have a little bit of history first, okay? Now today we're going to look at one of the most important and too often missed points of Christ's work here on earth. It's something that can be interpreted countless ways. But very few of those ways lead to a correct way of thinking about the law and how it relates to Christ. And this is nothing new. Satan has been splitting churches. He's destroyed relationships between believers, causing so many missed opportunities to reach people for Christ. Even before the start of the church, this was happening. By our lack of understanding God's law and how it applies to us, we see even before Christ came, we saw how it affected the Pharisees and people like that, and we'll look at it in a little bit. But this is going to be a little bit interactive, okay? So first, this will help to keep you awake with him. That's okay. Who can tell me where the law is in your Bible? Leviticus? What else? Any other parts? Do you remember what Moses had written down? Remember? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. That little bit right there. Don't do this to your Bibles, by the way. This is a special Bible. It's the broken binding edition. And in here, this little piece in here, there's this book of the law inside that. Leviticus has the whole law in there. We see other parts of it in other parts of the Bible. But it refers back to that little tiny section of this great big Bible. The law of Moses was given to us by God, and it's so important that we see. Remember Joshua? We talked about Joshua last week. We got to hear about Joshua. The first chapter for Joshua, it starts out with God speaking to Joshua. The first chapter after the conclusion of all these things that Moses had written down, God tells Joshua what he's supposed to do with the law, with that first section of the Bible. Joshua, he's the new leader of the nation of Israel following Moses' death, and he is the one who gets to lead all of Israel to the promised land. Yes, that's the same one that we got that song stuck in our head from last week. Actually, several songs. It's been a rough week. That was their first battle that we heard about last week in the Promised Land, and we see how it turned out. Why was Joshua such a strong leader, and why did the Israelites follow him when it didn't make any sense? I would encourage you to read about why in Joshua chapters 1 through 5, because we see how God used Joshua even before they got to that first battle, and how God set him up. This is something that we've been talking about in youth group, is how God set him up to be the leader of Israel. And even though it didn't make sense, they followed him because they knew that he was following God, and he was going to lead them where God wanted them to go. So I would encourage you to read that. He's why my son is named Joshua, him and another Joshua. And much of that comes from these particular verses here. Joshua chapter 1, verses 7 through 9. Only be strong and courageous. Be careful to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. You do not turn from it to the right or to the left, so that you may have success wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you should meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. One of my favorite verses right there. This book of the law that he's talking about with Joshua here was basically that little section that I showed you earlier. That's all they had of the Bible at that time. That little bit. And that's what Joshua was supposed to remember, meditate on it night and day. We have a lot more now, but that contained the law that was referred to here. It was their instruction manual. It contained the rules for living, the rules for worship, the rules for having a right relationship to God, and the rules for order among the nation of Israel. This was their law. God told Joshua at least four times to be strong and courageous. And the Lord was with him as he followed the law, and Israel did during his lifetime as well. That's another thing that was really cool about Joshua, is that Israel followed Joshua. He was such a strong leader that they stayed in right relationship while he was alive. Then skipping ahead, we see Israel fall away from the law or chase everything other than God as the leader of their lives. And the cycle of disobedience, the hurt, captivity, and restoration, that ongoing cycle for Israel for the next several generations. But they had this book of the law the whole time. They had these instructions for how to live and please God. They simply didn't always follow them. So now we have, what is a law? This is the technical definition from Merriam-Webster. And I thought it was really cool that at the bottom of that, after number two, it specifically talks about God's law. It's still referred to as the law here, even in every part of society. But it's a binding custom or practice of a community, a rule of conduct or action prescribed or formally recognized as binding or enforced by a controlling authority. And there's these definitions of what a law is. Basically, it's something that an authority says, this is what you have to do. This is what you have to follow to be right or to be acceptable. Often, we see here that number two, it also is referred to specifically of the revelation of the will of God set forth in the Old Testament. That's still called the law. One of the funny things about laws, though, is we have free will, right? Everybody has free will. We can choose to follow the laws, or we can choose to ignore the laws. But we do so knowing that there are consequences. Either way, it is still, in most cases, our choice to follow or not. Second thing about laws, they're only as good as the authority enforcing the laws. In a just, perfect society, laws are enforced equally and fairly all the time. As with the perfect author of the laws given to Moses, God is fair, God is just, and we count on that. We know that he is these things perfectly. And thirdly, we have them for a reason. We have laws for a reason. We don't always know what the reason is. There's some silly laws that we see in America that we're like, why can't I spit on the sidewalk on a Tuesday in some places? There's these weird things, but somewhere somebody knew it was a good idea to not have these, to make these laws. It must have been important to somebody, right? So they're for a reason. I have a picture here of a law, but first, let me show you the law of Moses again. That little bit right in there. Just a few pages, really. But now let me show you this. This pile of books, you know what a commentary is? This pile of books right here is commentary, just on that little section. I didn't want to take out a smaller section, but this section, that's the commentary from one man trying to explain these laws and explain what's written in that little bit. That's a lot of commentary, right? So we can see it's not always easy to understand. So we have these people like commentators or people who study and scholarly people who know what they're looking at, who can help us to understand and help us to read the Bible better by understanding things a little bit more clearly. These books right there are just for that little tiny section, right? Now, it's kind of like football. How many of you are football fans? Okay. How many of you are married to football fans? I'm married to a football fan. I was more of a baseball fan, but I'm learning. And, you know, you have football, and you don't have just the football game. Before it, you have about 4 hours of commentary. Then after it, you have about a week of commentary until the next game starts, unless it's the playoff. And then you have 7 months of commentary on what could be a 30-second play or just this little thing. It takes, and it's not just one show either. You might be watching one show, but all the different sports channels and radio shows, and everybody's talking about this one little tiny thing that happened during this one little tiny game. That's kind of like commentators with the Bible and in regards to the law. Whew. I'm sweating. It's not working. But these commentators, this one I said was just one man's trying to interpret this to make it easier to understand. If we took all of the commentators and stacked their books up here from all of time trying to understand the law, it would be a lot, right? One man's commentary. Now, speaking again of the law, pretty complicated stuff is written in this little section, right? It must be a lot for them to understand. Everything for them to know, and everything for moral living, salvation, conducting church, settling disputes, it was all in here. It's a lot for them to keep up with. But here's some perspective. That right there is one law, one American law. Any guesses as to which one? No? Oh, I thought this somebody would get it. Affordable Care Act. You've all heard of it, I'm sure. The Affordable Care Act. 2,700 pages is this one law in America. How many laws are in America? Thousands, right? Thousands and thousands of laws, if you count all the federal laws, all the state laws, local laws. There's a lot of laws. This is just one. Over 5,000 sections of the law. And regulations that came out of this law, that remember the law itself was 2,700 pages, over 20,000 pages of regulations and rules to correspond to the law. And then you have legal analysts and lawyers and all these other people trying to figure it out from every health insurance company, every hospital, trying to figure out what it all means. It's a lot. That's just one law. And we out of how many? Thousands in this country. But we seem to do okay. Most of us know what's right, what's wrong, what not to do, what's against the law, and what isn't. We simplify it. For this, in looking at that one law and thinking of all the other laws that we have, this little bit right here doesn't seem so bad anymore, does it? This was everything that they needed to know for settling disputes, for all the different things they had to deal with, remember? So it doesn't sound so bad anymore. And they had it all along. Now, it's a far cry from the original law that we had in this country, the Mayflower Compact, the very first one. The original law was all on one page. Anyway, it looked cool. But so moving on, in light of thousands of laws we live by every day, this doesn't seem to be that complicated anymore. We can even stay awake for that if we read it, because it's not that big, right? Now, fast forward several generations, and we see a group called the Pharisees. Speaking of grace, compassion, mercy, not like is what set them apart. They were looked up to by the Jews. They were put on a pedestal. And here comes Jesus speaking against the rules that they made, against their rituals, against their very positions as religious leaders. He called them out for everyone to see, over and over. He even called them a brood of vipers and spoke of future wrath that would be poured out, not on the Gentiles, but on them. This wasn't what they wanted to hear. They grew to despise him. They were the ones who were always right, remember? They knew the law. If anyone has a question, they had the answer. Well, we all know the rest of that story. They plotted and schemed, and eventually Jesus was beaten, crucified, and died for what they thought was blasphemy. But that wasn't the end of Jesus, thankfully. He rose again. He was seen alive. He spoke to people. He ate food. He even showed them his wounds. And he was alive and seen by many on several different occasions. At one point, over 500 people. Was Christ against the law? No, absolutely not. To the Pharisees, they didn't understand who Christ was. They put so much focus on all these other things that they missed the opportunity to see who Christ really was. He was never against the law. Remember, God gave the law to Moses. The problem was that people put their trust in keeping the law and failed to trust Jesus as Lord and Savior when he was revealed. They chose to hang on to their pride in their positions. They even tried to cover up the resurrection. Silence those who would speak of the resurrected Christ. And so began the persecution of Christians, the persecution of the early church from the very beginning. And now we skip ahead a little bit further, and we're going to see Paul now. That's where we pick up today. Once a zealot and persecutor of the church, now one of the most influential church planners, writing to the church at Philippi. Let's pray before we start today's piece. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you for what you've done for us, Lord. We thank you for your word, and help me to share it correctly, Lord. Help me to share what it is you have, and use me just as a tool of yours, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So, he starts out here, Philippians chapter 3, verse 1 is where we begin today. Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things again is no trouble to me, and it is a safeguard for you. Now, I know he said finally, but that's not an ending here, but a transition. He's been speaking of rejoicing and joy throughout the first two chapters, but this time he adds a phrase at the end. Did you catch it? In the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. The place from where our joy emanates is not dependent on circumstances or outside influences, but the sovereign, unchanging, and omnipotent Lord. Our joy doesn't depend on circumstances when our focus is on an unchanging God. Rejoice in the Lord, and not these other things which come and go. There are others who have forgotten that truth. The Pharisees were a group of people that had forgotten that truth. Where was their joy? You remember? It was in their positions, their pride, and their knowledge, their rituals, all these other things. They missed the point. Even though they studied so much, they missed what it was telling them. Thanks.
Oh, thank you. I know it's like
the weather. Yeah. It's just the weather. I never get nervous. No, that's good. All right. So, the scriptures they were studying, they loved more than anything else, even to the point of missing who Christ was. He continues in verse 2, saying, beware of the dogs, beware of the evil workers, beware of the false circumcision, for we are the true circumcision, who worship in the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus, and put no confidence in the flesh. Now, this was a warning for the Philippians. We are introduced here, or the Philippians are introduced to this new group of people, the newest threat to the church in their area, and the newest threat to the truth that was being proclaimed in Philippi, a warning against false teachers, comparing them to dogs. Not these dogs. These dogs. Yeah, vicious kind. These were the dogs that were familiar to people in that time. They were wild. They were vicious. They were uncontrollable, something the Jews normally called Gentiles. Remember the Gentiles, they were the ones that didn't follow rules. They were the ones that were like these guys, so they called them dogs. But instead, Paul calls this specific group of people called Judaizers. The false circumcision was this group of false teachers who were teaching that Gentiles who want to be Christians must become Jewish proselytes first. Remember that thing, the law? They were teaching that before you can become a Christian, you have to become a Jew and follow all these rules first, and then you can accept Christ, and that's how you get into heaven. This group of Judaizers, we see them a lot in Galatians first, the letter, a couple letters before this. We see Paul dealing with this group of people, and, well, we'll get to that. Must become Jewish proselytes first, follow all the Mosaic law, and then you could be allowed to become Christians. This was completely against, however, justification by faith, which is the essential piece of the New Testament. Jesus came, died on a cross, we follow him. He paid the price completely. We don't have to do these old things anymore. This was completely against that. They were preaching Jesus and following all the rules. Jesus and not eating certain meats. Jesus and. It was all these other things. Paul is basically saying, be aware that what these false teachers are telling you is heresy. All of those things, it's not about Jesus and. For each one of us, it's not Jesus and. Jesus paid the price in full. Instead, he shows us that the true circumcision isn't about the flesh. It's about getting rid of our pride and submitting to God's truth that we can't make it on our own. Submitting to God's commands to show that he is Lord, we recognize we need a Savior, and we worship him in the Spirit of God. We happily, joyfully accept the free gift of salvation and his plan for us instead of putting confidence in ourselves to make it or be good enough. We worship him because we recognize that he is the only one worthy of our praise. Here's the point. This is the part to take home and write down, okay, before you get your homework. Write this down. Here's the point. Any attempt to please God so that we earn heaven by our own effort or our own merit is in opposition to what Christ accomplished on Calvary and puts the focus on ourselves and not on Christ. We can do nothing to earn heaven. We deceive ourselves when we think, or when we equate the works that we do, or our faithfulness to doing the things of God, or anything of ourselves. We deceive ourselves when we think that is what's going to make us pleasing to God, when that makes us acceptable. Instead, it's the finished work of Christ. We can never do it on our own. We can never attain the perfection, complete righteousness, which is the requirement for heaven. And no amount of works will ever be enough, but praise God, he provided a way. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We were slaves to sin, and the wages of sin, as we know, is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. We earned death, but God gives us the free gift of life, eternal life in Christ Jesus. I could never make it on my own. None of you could ever make it on your own, and nobody that you know could ever make it on their own. No matter how good a person they might be, nobody's perfect. Nobody reaches that level of righteousness that only God can bestow on us through Jesus. We never could have made it on our own. So, looking back at what Paul says here, if anyone is going to make it to heaven in the flesh, it would be Paul, right? Remember who he was. He was a follower of the law. Well, we'll look at it here. Although I myself might have confidence even in the flesh, if anyone else has a mind to put confidence in the flesh, I far more. Circumcised on the eighth day. Here's his check. Circumcised on the eighth day of the nation of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. It doesn't get any more Jewish than that. It doesn't get any more Hebrew. He could trace his line back to which wife of Israel he descended from. As to the law, a Pharisee. Remember the legalistic traditionalist? He was a Pharisee who applied the law to every part of life, leading to strict and complicated rules and traditions to keep themselves set apart. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church, the zealots loved the law so much they hated anything that was against the law and their religious system. As to righteousness, which is the law, or which is in the law, blameless. Not that he was blameless because of his following the law perfectly, but rather outwardly showing everyone how righteous he was by what he did, along with that self-righteousness, king pride, and now he realizes that, as he continues in verse 7. But whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss, as a loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be loss in view of the surpassing value of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish so that I may gain Christ and may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith. That's the key. Even though he could have put all his confidence and all his trust in all those things that he had before knowing Christ, which many of his colleagues, or whatever you want to call them, his group, that's what they did. They put all their trust in all these other things instead of the one truth, instead of the truth that gives us righteousness, that it was self-righteousness instead of God's righteousness. And Paul is using accounting terms here, gain and loss. You've heard that before. Keeping record, trying to make things add up to eternity in heaven. All the things he once thought were to his credit, he now realizes were meaningless. All the things he was so proud in his walk were self-righteousness, not God's righteousness. And all this time he'd been deceiving himself into thinking he could do it. He could be enough if he followed the rules. But here's the thing about the law. It was never intended to make a person righteous. For more on that, this is your homework. Please read Galatians chapter 3, because we don't have time today. So you're going to read Galatians 3, and you're going to see how this all works together. That what the law was for and what Christ did and how they relate. There's a lot of it through all of Galatians, but specifically Galatians chapter 3. So write that down, and there will be a quiz next time I speak. Maybe. All right. So the Israelites were not given the law, through Moses as a checklist of what not to do so they could make it to heaven. That was never its intent. The law was given that they would know what to do in obedience to cover their sins until the Lord came. The law was pointing ahead to the Savior all along. God didn't just make the law for us to earn heaven. Instead, Adam and Eve were already sinners in need of a Savior. The requirement to cover their sins was blood. Adam and Eve brought death into this world, and the law gave them a path to eternal life through faith as they looked ahead to the coming Savior. It was never about the law or this list that they had to follow. It was always about faith. To know Christ, as Paul did, is not just on an intellectual level. Remember what he said up there about, oh wait, where did I read that part yet? Yeah, I read that part. Okay, so to know Christ as Paul did is not just on an intellectual level. It speaks of personally experiencing new life in the Son. Paul used a Greek verb equivalent to sharing life with Christ, which interestingly corresponds to a Hebrew word that describes God's knowing of his people personally, experientially. Experientially, yes. He knows us personally. He knows what we go through. He's right there with us. That's the same, or not the same word, because it's a different language, but a similar word as to what Paul is describing here about knowing Christ. Do we know him personally? Do we know him experientially? Do we see him at work in our lives? That's what this was. It wasn't about following the rules. He never experienced that when he was doing all these other things and persecuting the church, obviously. God got a hold of him on that road and made him come to the point where he had to trust God. And we see the change that it made in his life. And now he's sharing that with others. It's not about all these other things. It's about Jesus. And 3, verse verse 9 here. To be found in him, back in verse 9, to be found in him in Christ was, this was only possible because Christ covers us in his righteousness. His shed was enough, or shed blood was enough to wash away our sins and fulfill the law. He paid the price for us. It was never self-righteousness that saved us, but always, whose righteousness? God's righteousness. Making me a brand new creation. Not a better version of ourselves. Brand new. That's the work of Christ. Freedom from sin. Freedom to follow him. The false teachers, the Judaizers, were missing the fact that Jesus paid it all. On the cross he said, it is finished, right? Not, it's finished, and now you guys just have to do this and become Jews first. That's what the Judaizers thought. Make sure that we don't become, or we have to be careful to make sure that we don't add to what Christ did, or add any rules, or try to guess whether someone's saved by the way that they are living. That's not our role to do. We share Christ with people. We share the truth of what he's done. We share what he's done for us. That personal experience speaks a lot to people. Instead, this is the work of Christ that we share with people. Don't become legalistic. That's what the warning here is for us. Don't esteem rituals or traditions as equally important or required for salvation as faith in Christ and believing in him alone. That's the key to salvation. That's what we need to focus on, is sharing God's message with others. Sharing that Christ loves them and that Christ died for them. That's the important part. Jesus didn't nullify the law or add to the law. Jesus Christ fulfilled the law for all who will believe. Rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things again is no trouble to me, and it is a safeguard for you. When we think of rejoicing in the Lord, that's where we take our pride. That's where we and get our joy from, is what he's done for us, not from anything else. Because that's where we find satisfaction. That's where we find comfort in times of need. That's where we find peace. Rejoice in the Lord. Tell about what he's done in your life. And one last time. Rejoice in the Lord. And say it again. It's no trouble for me, and it's a safeguard for you. I keep saying it. It's no trouble for me, but I won't do that. We're going to pray, and we're going to go down and do. So go ahead and stand with me as we pray together, and then we get to go enjoy each other's fellowship. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your love for each one of us, Lord. We thank you for what you did and what you accomplished when none of us could. Lord, we thank you for every bit of your word, even the parts that we don't, that all of it points to you, Lord, and we thank you for that. We just pray that you would help us to understand it clearly and be able to share that with people around us, Lord, that you would help us to understand how much you love us and help others around us to see that too, and help others to see you through us, I pray, Lord. Be with us now as we go downstairs and share in fellowship and food, and bring us back next week as we worship again. And Lord, help us this week to remember these truths, that it's